short history. So I used to be a GP for a beach runner, and as a result of that, my ribs pulled, torn, twisted, and broken just about every part of my body, which I'm now paying the price. But as a result of that, I was highly motivated to get better, which led me to learning how to fix myself and then developing an interest in doing that. So I've been an osteopath now for about 25 years. I've done a lot of work with the league sport, not so much for cycling, but I've worked with membership rugby, football, I've worked on the HP Tour, I've worked with the UK Athletics, and I've worked with Paralympics as well. So I'm still a bit sport obsessed, and I got into cycling probably about 25 years ago as a sort of a recreation from the running, and now as my sort of running has taken up the back seat. I'm still obsessed with trying to make myself better and my patients better, so I do a lot of different approaches to treatment, so I might be a little bit different to the average osteopath.
Okay, so rules of engagement, as the last talks, please ask questions as we go. So we may or may not do a Q&A at the end. We expect you want to have a question or a point to raise, an observation, we make it as we go live, because that will change the complexion of the talk and the direction of the talk. So rather than leaving for the end, you guys have to do that.
I was going to say, probably the only caveat with that, because everyone's going to say, well, I've got this particular open thing. We can talk about things generally, but in all honesty, we need to sort of examine you and look at you to go into real sort of specific details.
Right, so there's no laying on the hands when you're curious about it. Other than that, raise your hands and then come with a question.
Oh, really? What is the fundamental difference
between osteopath is actually the next question. Who wants to take that?
I would say that so physios, we did the whole training with physiotherapists, and we find physiotherapists in a hospital with stroke patients, with pediatrics, respiratory. So there's a helix, there's a whole movement of physiotherapy. Then you have a specialisation of musculoskeletal physiotherapy, which you find in outpatients,
How do you coordinate that? Do you go to the Cyclefit session and actually do that analysis at that point?
Yeah, if possible. So I might certainly come in on Cyclefit sessions with individuals. I have patients that are coming to my clinic and say, look, we need to see you, we need to make that fit. I will come in whilst we're in the fit kit so that we can do that and let's go at the same time. And that way, actually, that's a really effective way of sort of jumping things along the journey.
It's only taken us 20 years to work under the same roof.
Yeah.
and that's right. So sometimes what you'll find is, on occasion, you'll find that Right, the next question, next thing to approach is how is the bike different? How is the bike different? You come from a running background, 400 meter sprinter, Commonwealth Games, so that's your background, international running. So how is the bike different in terms of constraints upon the athlete and the constraints upon the body? How do you see that being different athletic environment?
I mean, the most obvious one is keeping out of the constraints. You know, you are fixed, the pedals are fixed, the pedal are fixed, the handlebars. And that imposes constraints on the body that you then have to be able to bend. The more aggressive those constraints are, the more resilient or pliable your body has to be to bend. And what we typically see is problems come about where don't have the resilience to cope with those constraints. Whereas with running, I bet you just have to, you know, two tiny little points of contact, and the rest of the body can kind of do almost anything. So this is just sort of different types of injuries. And obviously, that you run something more impact based, which you're not going to get the time with the repetition.
But is that a cultural thing? Obviously, well, achievement through suffering when you're on the bike. This, you know, this subtext to what this is actually is, and you know, how do you differentiate between, you know, I'm going to give it a go versus, oh my God, I can't go anymore. You know, how do you get a balance right?
I think you differentiate between, you know, good pain and bad pain. Mm-hmm. You know, we're all pretty, you know, we're sensory disorders, sort of like endorphin junkie quality to most of us. You know, we like how exercise hits, and that is very different from how that just hurts and it's getting worse. And it's actually going to then stop me getting my endorphin getting to my heart attack. And that is very different. And then it's understanding how to get to that.
not makes a lot of your position where you want to be. So again, and then we're in this flex position on spine and to take position. So it's not normal by any means, it's not natural. We think it's natural because we do it enough and it feels natural. Mm-hmm. Every time on the bike it feels great, but it's not actually a normal, functional, natural position for the body, which means that then we develop this tightness and stiffness and back to go with the other position, which isn't natural, which is spinning at a desk or that you've made in lockdown or a bed or something or what's going on, but that is also not natural. So there's two things combined, which is what a lot of us tend to do without the movement into other planes, means that we are become more restricted, the window of robustness becomes more narrow.
What are some of the leading indicators, meaning a tight dimension, tight hip flexors, so that then also lead to X, to Y, without getting to specific injuries? Because my experience as a runner, knees start to go first, as a cyclist, it's knees, it's back, it's neck. Just be interested in leading indicators to watch out.
There is a hierarchy of overuse injuries in cycling. Interestingly, in a typical muscle strength practice, tendency more of anything than that. In cycling, the order is necks, knees, groins and buttocks, hands, and then the back. This is the overuse order as a general rule. The things that we probably see in our practice a lot, the reasons are, again, because most of us are doing some sort of desk-based job. So thoracic and rib restriction is probably a big driver, because you need a little bit of mobility through your system to compensate. And again, if you're getting your neck strained, because your neck's the only thing that's actually moving at all or able to move because nothing else does. And we can probably demonstrate that with a little experiment. I love those audience participation. So try this and we'll bear with. So what I would like you to do, if you're just sort of sitting up comfortably, imagine that you're riding along, and you want to look over your right shoulder because you're thinking about making sure you take the traffic, and just see how that feels to look over your right shoulder. Now what I want to do is we're going to start to add some constraints. So if we bring our feet and knees together, we're going to move. And now look over the right shoulder. You'll probably find that slightly less easy than it was. Maybe. If you now bring your hands and elbows together. And now look over the right shoulder. Getting harder, perhaps, and then you can do what everyone else does, which is all of that makes slump a bit as well. And now look over your right shoulder. How many of you can feel your neck straining in that position? You can see why the neck suddenly starts to become the victim at the end of that chapter. Because you actually need this rib movement of thoracic mobility. While you're sitting on the bike, you're not really aware that you're using it, but you still need it to be able to move. So the sort of the antithesis of that is actually, if you're to sit up nice and tall, with your legs a little bit apart, and keep your sort of toes sort of arms and swing your heels to the left a little bit, and now start to turn so that your pelvis can slot. You can kind of see I can sort of do the exercises and have my 360s around me, because now I'm allowing my whole body to move. Which shows just how, between how many of those little restrictions and my whole way up that chain, you can then become a little bit of a life plan. And you'll see someone like Nick or myself,
exactly how much play you've got in your cleats as well.
Absolutely. Yeah, and so it doesn't have to be a lot. You've got to have a little bit of force transmission. Again, you know, away from something, we had I saw a cavity stroke in level over. Came in with back pain. And I've been scanned and examined and seen everyone basically. No one could get the spot in the back pain and scanned and looked at that. And we looked at it and said, okay, show us the side folding. He had a shoulder restriction. So he's going to bring his arm to here, and he can only bring it to there. So he was doing that every time. And it's really obvious once you see it and you realise it, but it's those constraints that will drive the pain in the body and sort of picking those out. And it could be anywhere in that chain. That's what we do, interesting trying to sort of do the detective bit and trying to work it out. No, it's a thing, you know, in terms of getting people to do stuff to mobilise through this, you then need to give them exercises to do that. And again, if possible, you give them exercises in a sport-specific or bike-specific position. So if I'm going to get you to do something like this, I'm going to get you to do it sitting. And if you want a bit of audience participation, if you sit up, and this will be interesting as well. So if you sit up tall, I want you to reach down with your left hand to your left ankle. So again, it's really interesting to watch. Everyone just sit up for a second. It's really interesting to watch how you look. There's a couple of ways you can bend forward. You can bend forward by most of us, which is just you bend at the back and kind of curl. Or you can bend like you ideally would do and actually sort of bend forward with your pelvis. Okay, to reach the water. In that position, you can hold that. Thank you. So again, from there, then you could do your rotation exercise. And I can bring you my neck. But I can add in a constraint. I might be in a funny position. So if I put my hand on my head, I've now rocked this corner. So if I move my head and my elbow around, I have to move through my forehead. So now if I'm going into that position and try and twist, what I'll feel is that I can only move through my ribcage. At which point you start to realise either how much or how little movement you've got in that area. But the other thing to realise, particularly as we enlighten, is it doesn't work to go crashing away at that as well. So, you know, when you're doing that sort of stretching and mobilisation, it needs to be gentle. And a little and often gently works much more effectively than trying to crank it like I did when I was 18.
So talking about flexibility, and earlier you mentioned bringing the bike to you rather than using the bike.
try and do is think about how the human form could work better with the constraints of which you want. It's too late to change what you want to really. That will try and fail. So what you end up with, you end up changing what you can, which is short things like shorter cranks, narrower bars, rotate some of the central gravity forwards, increase things like wheel base flexibility, lower bottom brackets, so tall riders like Alex don't feel like they have a chopper over every time they ride the bike. So you end up changing the margins to make things, you know, incrementally better. It's too late to change the species unless there was some kind of, you know, cultural kind of revolution, you know, sort of a $1 billion to really let the species then have it. Well, that was a speciation event. So a speciation event was in 1933. A guy called Moshe came up with a different design of bike. And Oscar Riddick had the record for the hour. And in 1919, it was bonkers fast. Even then, it was bonkers fast, 27 miles an hour. Crazy. And then Moshe designed just like a recumbent bike, gave it to a second guy, a cat rider, a guy called Frederick Faraday. Laughter in the velodrome in France, laughter. And Casares, the second cat rider, was not a great rider, he was okay. But he took this kind of semi-incumbent design and smashed Moscow's record. And so no one laughed after that because his record stood for years, 1933. And so then the design got banned. Moshe incorporated the design into a whole cultural revolution where slightly electrified vehicles. Anyway, that was what that bit of a sidetrack. And that's a speciation. So this became what was recognized as bicycle sport. And by enshrining this is a almost identifiably a bicycle sport, creates romance around it, and then we all kind of got invested in it, and now it's happening. And I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm not just saying that's how it is. So we have to change things in the margins because we can't change this, because Nicola's right. We didn't evolve to ride bikes. We evolved to run and jump, etc., etc. But we're stuck with it now. And it's good enough. It's good enough. It's not great, but it's good enough. So we have changed the margins for what we can. I'm not sure I've answered your question.
You kind of have, but also, if this is a kind of Darwinian challenge, i.e. we're getting older, we're analogue, and that thing is just unbelievable. You know, what would we look like if we'd actually adapted to that? You know, like a giraffe, I don't know. How, you know, what would we do to kind of mitigate this constant change?
This is right, this is what Nicola and Alex are saying. So in the first instance, opening statements in the talk, you know, in the first instance we're trying to take this, in the second instance we're going to try to take it. We're going to try and evolve with you as an individual rather than a species. We're going to try and look at how can we help you fit to this, and that's going to be giving you ranges. So when Nick was talking about flex spine, flex hip, you know, no one involved in place all the flex spine. So let's give you more range to do just that. If we're going to sort of tilt you onto your arms, onto your hands, let's give you a trunk strength to do that and still function at a high level. You know, so it's about evolving you, if you like, with a specific personal kind of evolution journey to ride this bike.
But just to continue to that, and, you know, to the provocative question, is that a fool's errand? Should people of our age actually be aspiring to ride that sort of bike? What's the benefit? Or are we actually storing up harm for ourselves by contorting ourselves into this position with some help to make ourselves feel good that we can ride this bike? Is actually the smarter move to take a more relaxed position and focus on the things that you can really not just improve but preserve at our age? Controversial question, but just for the sake of
the question. Well, then you can come to it. First, we're picking on this bike. But this bike is here because we absolutely love it. This is silly. And no, if you've got an aspiration to ride this bike, and you should, I mean, it's just a holding in the fun to ride a bike this fast. Whatever your image, frankly. And I know it's absolutely amazing. So, you know, answering the question, yes,
if you have altered it, tightened your pairs, if you've got restriction in your ribs, it's a very limited functional position. It's then very difficult to rotate your pelvis to get that into a position to access your glutes. So if you're in a slumped position, it's very difficult to perform well. So I would say if you come back from a bike ride, lie on your roller and open out your chest, like lie on a roller towel, do something that's reversing to being in that position.
is there a, this is about education, depending on your style, your physiology, all the rest of it, isn't the industry kind of comparable, because the seduction starts when that happens, and then we go out and go, right, that's me done, and you're let go with this machine that you're not qualified or built for, and left to get on with it, you know, the repair has had their cut, and you're left with the fallout. Does that make sense?
Yeah, well, I mean, my heart breaks when it comes in, I'm looking at it, it's not going to happen.
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't know, the way to do that is you go for a clear for us.
Yeah. I mean, we have choice, and if this is choice architecture, all of it, I'm just curious that if this is about education, if you can go further upstream and start with, don't let someone walk through the door and just jump straight on the track and disappear, go, look, with all the best will in the world, that's not going to happen. I'm here to help you get going before you get going. You know, is that a more honest way of doing it, you know, where everyone wins rather than you ending up seeing the kind of, I've got the machine, but I'm not ready?
The best thing you can do is go and see my doctor first.
Yeah.
And a lot of them pick up and say that. And then within their ranges, they divide by different geometries. And then the bike is just got dieting is the best thing to do. And then we see some riders come in and maybe, so like in this brand, they have a bike that demands an endurance bike, which is higher, closer. And they might into their cycle by that for 3 years, and then the next five applies from the list because they've got themselves fitter, they're enjoying it more, and then they're inspired to do this. But we must realise that this is a very fast racing bike for mostly fairly young men and women to go to. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily always while it's a country all this time, but it goes fast as well.
There isn't a great deal of adjustment with it, I guess, integrated, but then that brings restrictions to, I guess, what you can do around the bike, practically.
There is less adjustment on bikes now than there used to be. There's a lot of, but what people come into us would say, that German brand that we don't like to talk about, you can see, and not to know if I'm German, and they come in and say, can you feel a bit fitter now when you're like, you can move the saddle up and down, you can move backwards and forwards, but you need to. Having said that, doesn't use a fit bike, we can find an ideal position, and then you can try that.
We've talked a lot about, you know, what you can do in terms of, you know, stretching and trying to get flexibility and movement when you're not on the bike. But depending on your riding style, the idea of, you know, recovery and, you know, when should you push and when should you hold up, depending on your riding style, you know, because if recovery is really important to muscle growth development and your body's health, then, you know, what, how do you balance the two? Go with it, rest, go with it.
And
use of language, I think. So again, as an osteopath, what my patient's going to say, yes, I put something out of place. Your spinal bones do not actually go out of place, or out, or shopping, or on holiday. And I'm quite pedantic about my use of language, because people actually freak out at the thought that something is out. They're like, they're dislocated their spine. You can certainly get muscle spasm that compresses it to search out. You can have these bent out of posture, so you kind of look like you're bent like a question mark, but it's not that the joints are dislocated. It's because, they're just jammed up, particularly on one side, where you have muscle spasm that's stopping you from moving. So it's the language. The other one that I also kind of guess is, and this came about for a lot of the core stability research sort of 15, 20 years ago, this concept of stability and instability. So then I had a lot of patients coming and saying, I've got an unstable pelvis. And again, you kind of think just the whole concept of that's going, if it was unstable, it would just kind of fall apart. Your pelvis is inherently very, very stable. But it creates these catastrophizations in people's head, which then affects how they really hold themselves. So then I would say these patients would just brace all the time like this, and then never switch off.
Can probe on that point about catastrophizing. So I did have a herniated L5S1 disc. I don't want to get back there. 3 years of osteopaths, physiotherapists, consultant neurosurgeons. I am paranoid about having that again.
Yeah.
And I'm sure there's something built into the way I cycle, the way I walk, protecting my back constantly. I've got no idea whether I should do that or not do that. But I do think when you've had an injury, your body compensates, right? How it compensates, I think, does dictate a lot about the future. Shouldn't do that.
And that's part of our job, is to, in some cases, it's not just getting me out of pain, it's building resilience and confidence back in my system again. So the fact that you have that injury does mean you should be able to do anything you want in the future. But people think, you see people that are terrible, because if you have that sort of severe pain, of course I have it. It's pretty hideous. You don't appreciate how bad it is. And you don't want to get nice people that sort of walk here and it's the bracing.
Yeah.
The irony of that is the bracing then produces pain.
Yeah.
It's like walking around with a clenched fist and evolving these clenched fists as much as you can. We'll just talk amongst ourselves. But you can imagine that's going to feel like it relaxed.
Yeah.
You can imagine that's going to feel like in 10 minutes' time. Now, I see people that have been clenching for 6 months, and they've got raging back pain. The irony of it is, you teach them to unclench, and that pain literally disappears in a couple of minutes. Because what they're doing is that belief that is driving the pain. And someone comes, you see that little brace attached to your bike, and there is absolutely no reason for your stomach to be sucked in whilst you're sitting on the bike. And that bracing strategy causes stiffness in your, not just in your back, but in your hips, your knees, and even your ankles. And it limits your load attenuation, your impact attenuation. So it's like that jolt or any force that just really gets you through those structures, and you're much more likely to irritate those
overall understanding of it's not just about my hands doing this, it's about actually getting, you know, movement into my lower back. It's not just about this, it's about that as well. And then making sure that my training is developing all of these things kind of in sync with each other. And that to me, you know, feels right, but it's a daunting challenge to actually get to that position, right? You know, help me get there.
Thank you.
Junction layers in this line, where this line is going to go where the high load points are. Discs are an interesting thing, and very briefly. So it is over the age of 30, 80% must have bulging disc. Over the age of 40, 90% must have bulging disc. So it's like wrinkles on the outside, it's wrinkles on the inside. There was a really interesting piece of research back in 2005 that looked at the correlation between imaging and low back pain. If you had a lumbar disc bulge, you were 2.5 times less likely to have low back pain. So bulging disc